Good. Let's just open in prayer and we'll get rolling. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to share and grow together. And Lord, I pray as we look into your word today, as we look into some things, I just pray, Father, you will be exalted and glorified. And even when we look at things maybe a little differently than we've heard or researched in our past, Lord, I pray that we'll be open to what you want to do and accomplish today. We thank you for this time and the opportunity. We give you glory right now. We ask you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 All right, we'll get right into this. This session is called Moving the Sticks. When Jamie asked me about speaking and gave me the topic, obviously this, we're going to talk about some of the analysis of football in a little bit here. So if you aren't familiar with football terminology, there might be a few times that you get lost, and if you do, just ask the person beside you.
Well, you know about football, right?
No, I do not. I was going to ask you.
Is that European football?
No. Okay, so moving the sticks, maintaining spiritual growth. The subtitle, how to go about developing a relationship with God and not letting this relationship become stagnant, but alive and thriving. This is something that I believe every believer, man, woman, child, every believer desires to have this to some degree. I don't think anybody says, you know what, I'm okay with being mundane. I'm okay. Everybody wants to have a growing, thriving relationship with God. And we're going to talk a little bit about that today. So let's look at the scripture. We're going to look at Matthew 16, what we're going to use. Matthew 16, 13 through 18. So I'll read this. If you have a Bible, if not, you can see on the screen what it says here. Verse 13 says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But what about you? He asked. Who do you say I am? We know Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by the flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. And I tell you you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. Now, right at the beginning here, this is Peter's confession of Christ. This is the time that Peter makes this declaration. And Peter's already had a relationship with Jesus. He's already been a disciple and a follower. But this is a point that is very interesting. This is a very hinging time period for Peter. The thing that's interesting about this, if you're following Jesus, and Jesus says, I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will overcome it. As a believer, as a follower, you would think, okay, I've attained something pretty significant. Sometimes you could even say, I have arrived at whatever the goal is. Because if Jesus now has said, okay, you get it. You've maybe have been following me for some time, but you get it. You understand this, and this has been revealed by God the Father himself, not just by what you've heard or seen, but by God. So with this, we start off with thinking, okay, Peter could say, okay, I can retire from ministry. I've arrived. His goals in life maybe have been fulfilled. But the reality of it is, Peter needed much, much more and go much further and deeper. Sometimes when we get to a certain place in our life, we can think, okay, I've arrived, I've accomplished it, I've got my degree, I've gone to Bible college, I've gone to whatever college, I got my certificates. But there's so much more than that. So we're going to talk about a few points for this. And the first one is identifying person and position. Now here's where we're going to get into some of the football terminology. Jesus says to Peter, but what about you? Who do you say that I am? And Peter's response is, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. A lot of times in that time period, there was already an establishment of you are teacher. You are miracle worker. And there's all these different things. But at this point, it's almost like Peter's eyes were opened and said, well, you are the Messiah. And that's a pretty significant declaration for a man in this time period to say, you are the anointed one. You are the chosen one. This wasn't just something that everyone could recognize Jesus as a significant figure in that time period. Everyone kind of would watch all the different activities, as could see the healings that take place. They could see the prophetic voice of Jesus. They could see all these things. But Peter talked about the Messiah, the anointed one. It's actually taking it a step higher in understanding this. So what Peter does is he identifies the person and the position. Now, the reason that I look at this in applying this with football, if you ever watch, especially an NFL game, relatively early in the game, they put along the bottom of the screen the person and the position. Whoever's on defense first, they'll typically put their defensive line up and their defensive position. And sometimes they have little video clips and they'll say what college they came from or whatever, and then the offense is the same way. So right away they identify their name, their person, they identify their position, their role. Well, that's what Peter was doing here, and whenever he identified Jesus as more than just a mentor, he's a Messiah. So what I want to do is just spend a few moments, this is where you guys are going to have a little bit of interaction, is who is Jesus to you? If Jesus were to say to you, you know, at first Jesus says, well, who do people say? Who do the masses say that I am? And then they went through the litany of names. And then he comes at them and says, well, who do you say that I am? So let me just offer that up to you guys. If you think, okay, this is who Jesus is in my life, how do you answer that? Who is Jesus to you?
You're looking at me.
I'm looking at you. Okay.
So it's funny because I preached this, and like this is something that God has laid on my heart, so it's something I've thought about. And whenever I was asking the Lord, like, Lord, who are you to me? And he said, I'm your satisfaction. Because there's a lot of times in my life that I try to go through life and find satisfaction in doing things for the Lord and like working and working and working. In all reality, he already is my satisfaction. All I have to do is like rest in what he's already done to be satisfied.
That's good. Someone else? Who is Jesus to you?
I got saved about 28, even though I grew up in a Christian home. But I remember as a young man praying straight to God because let's just cut out the middleman, you know. And I kind of see the error of my ways in that now. But now when I'm tempted to do something, I think about like the Mel Gibson movie and Jesus' hand and the nail. And I think about, I'm about ready to do that to him. And so I really identify now as my Savior, the one that would have done it if I was the only one that would have ever done it. And many times as I force myself to think about his sacrifice, that it gives me the strength to not follow through in the temptation.
Gotcha. Good.
I think we all can recognize the Savior, Redeemer, Healer, and all those things, but to me, it's my friend. He's my friend. And I think that's so cool. Because yeah, there's times in our lives that we know we're saved. We know that he's redeemed us. But sometimes you just need a friend.
Yeah.
And it's easy just to call out to your friend.
Good.
I feel the same way. When I need somebody to build me up, I go to him. I talk to him constantly. Verbally, I'm just talking to him. Because in this world today, I mean, we have a lot of stuff that's going on. I mean, we get bombarded with a lot of stuff, too. And I'm just keeping constant contact with him just so I can hear his voice and he can tell me, hey, listen, you know, you need to do this, okay? You need to do that. You need to go this way. You need to, you know, and keep, you know, keep focused on what you're doing, what you, you know, your goal here. A lot of times we lose focus in that.
Sure.
And I found myself, when I wasn't in contact with him, I found myself drifting away and you know, not actually doing what he wanted me to do. And not less paying attention to that voice. And I just learned to stop that and concentrate.
Sure. That's part of the concept of what we're talking about is how do we, not only in our relationship with God, not only do we maintain that relationship, but how do we keep it growing and thriving and exciting? So sometimes we do become stagnant, and we need to understand how do we make that shift. Anyone else that want to share?
I know what my brother was saying back here, but I see Jesus kind of like as a facilitator. I mean, he's my Savior, and that's the only way I can get to God. But I go through Jesus to get to the Father for answers for prayer, you know. And then I go through Jesus for the Holy Spirit thing. Christ, I need more of your Spirit in me to guide me with discernment, gifts of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. So to me, he's my friend. I love what Chuck said. He is. He's our friend, our advocate. He's right there. But to me, he's kind of like the facilitator that gets me to every personality of the Godhead.
Mm-hmm. That's good. Anybody else want to chime in?
That may not be good theology, I don't know.
Works in the chaos of life. He's there. He's the rock. He's the calm in the storm.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what he is to me.
Good. Anyone else?
I would just use the word foundation. Good. Rock foundation. Mm-hmm. That's security.
Good. See, the thing is with what we're doing here is we're talking about the identifying the person in position. Going back to the football game, you can have a name, but if you don't understand their role, you miss their totality of their purpose. And with Jesus, we know him by name. And if you go to church or even if you watch television and everything, we've heard enough of Jesus and Savior. But to really have an identification of what that means, I want to take a little step further, which is what you guys did. This is exactly what I was looking for. One of the things we must understand about this is the relationship aspect. All these different words and phrases and things dealt with in one way or another the relationship we have with Jesus. And if you've been in the church for 2 weeks, you've heard the phrase, it's not about a religion, it's about a relationship. And we say that. And people say, well, you're religious. No, I'm not religious. It's not about religion. It's relationship. But the thing is, the reality of it is, a lot of times when we talk about growth, remember, we're talking about growing and moving forward in our relationship and our growth with God. A lot of times when we think of that aspect, we actually become very religious in nature. Let me explain. Somewhere along the line, the mentality has been taught or developed that to get closer to Jesus, we need to read the Bible more. To get closer to Jesus and have a better relationship with Jesus, we need to pray more. And I'm not standing up here, don't take this the wrong way, I'm not standing up here and saying we don't need to read the Word, and I'm not saying we don't need to pray. But the concept is to have a deeper relationship with Jesus, if we use the mentality, because this is how you do it, we got to realize that we are actually taking religious concepts of, okay, I got to get my 3 chapters in today. I got to get my my half hour of prayer in today. And we have these things that we have these religious exercises. And although what we're doing isn't a bad thing, but it's religious in nature because it's very systematic. And it has to be this much. And if I'm going to be significant, I look at Pastor Jim, and Pastor Jim prays 3 hours a day. So if I'm going to be spiritual, then I need to figure out how I can pray for 3 hours a day. And that is actually very religious in the mindset. And as I begin to look at this, you know, there's something that the Pharisees had. They're called phylacteries. And what a phylactery was a small leather box, basically, that had scriptures in it. And rather than taking scriptures from Exodus and bringing it into their heart and living out the principles of the scriptures, they put them in little things on their arm or on their forehead to demonstrate that they are attached to the Word of God. And on their arm, when they would cross over their heart, it would say that the Word, because it says in Exodus about the Word being on your heart. They actually took the physical concept of this and in your mind. But the reality of it is sometimes we take the concepts of what should be used to develop a more mature person and we make it religious by, I just got to get my 3 chapters in today. There are people that know more memorized scripture than I'll ever hope to know. But those same people can also be very, very bitter, very nasty people.
Come on.
But the knowledge that they have of the Word of God is amazing. So what does that mean? That means it's up here, but it's not in here. So when we look at how do we develop a relationship, how do we deepen our relationship with Jesus, let's take off the guilt of I have to do it this way, in this day. Because the reality of it is, if we say, okay, my goal for 2017 is to read 3 chapters of the Word of God every single day. And, you know, there's several different things about you can read through the entire Bible in a year. And you have all these things that you need to do and read this and read that much. And people that do this, and what happens if we miss a day? Oh, man, I've fallen from grace. I've failed the Lord. How about we have 2 or 3 days that maybe we're ill or we slept in or whatever might have happened, and we start bringing this guilt upon ourselves. God, I have failed you. Now, don't take this to say we don't need to put effort and discipline into doing this. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is let's remove the guilt that religion puts on to learn and do it in this certain way. Amen. The reality of it is, the Bible says we should pray without ceasing. So it shouldn't be working for 30 minutes a day. It should be working for 24 hours a day. And if we do that, and we think in every aspect of what we do, we're in constant communication and constant relationship with Jesus. It's not about, we don't need to be guilty about, I didn't get 30 minutes in my prayer closet. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. And there's certain times and certain seasons in our life that we want to do that. And God has, even for me, has said, I want you for this time period, I want you to separate yourself and do this. And that's okay. But just because God says that to me doesn't mean I need to go to Trevor and say, you know what, for you to be spiritual, you need to do exactly what I'm doing or else you're not spiritual. Mm. And sometimes we can, whether consciously or subconsciously, teach that mentality. Mm. So we need to be aware of that. Be careful of that. Don't become guilty. Don't become discouraged. Don't become depressed, because that's not of God. If we don't get our certain amount of time in for this, certain amount of time in for that, it should be something that's constant. So the first thing we need to understand this is identifying our relationship, identifying the person, identifying the position. The second thing I want to look at is obtainable goals. Obtainable goals. And here we're going to get a little more football analogy. Obtainable goals. Now, in a football game, at any given time, the offense has the ball, no matter where they are. If they're on the 5-yard line or if they're on the 50-yard line. The ultimate goal in a football game is the other goal line. That's the ultimate goal in that series. There's no time to just say, you know what, we're just going to hang out here for a little while. We have really nothing, you know, we have nothing going on. There's no reason to really put a whole lot of effort. The purpose of this is to get to the goal line. Now, sometimes if you think about it, if you follow football, if you look at, okay, they've received the kickoff and they've received a punt, they're at their 5-yard line. 95 yards away is that end zone. That looks really, really far. And if we have to accomplish that in 4 plays, that's going to be a tremendous feat that we're trying to do. Sometimes we look at our life as a parallel, we look at our life and we say, I want to be a person who is fulfilled in my job and financially secure in our family, and we want all these things, and we look at the end result. Okay, this is where I want to be. And then we take a few steps like, man, it's so far away. But just like in football, we have stages. So I'm going to ask Trevor and Pastor Jim to come on up here a second.
What?
You got your exercise clothes on.
Well, I do.
Yeah. Let's see you jog up there.
I haven't did that today.
Now, for the purpose of this illustration...
Do I get to tackle you?
Hey! For the purpose of this illustration, we're not going 10 yards. Typically, you know, in a football game, even 10 yards apart. What these are, first down markers, and whenever you look at the ultimate end goal, and you think that's so far away, but in football, thank goodness, when we start at this point, we only have to see ourselves getting past that point.
Good point.
All right, so let's say on Monday, where we start here. On Monday, we take a few steps and we have a good day. We are pleasant to one another and we're productive at work and everything's going well and everything's going wonderfully. So we took a few steps in the positive direction. All right, Tuesday, we took a few more steps. Now we can still say, man, it's still where I want to be is so, so far away. But we're going to take a few more steps, and maybe now we're here. Now, realizing that all I'm trying to accomplish is an obtainable goal, is I just want to get past where Pastor Jim is. That's all I want to do. Because then I can, in a sense, start over. Now, sometimes within the 10 yards in a football game, you might do a play that doesn't work out. You might get knocked back a little bit. So maybe at work, you got there early to get your reports printed and you want to do everything in the printer jam. So you're there and you're waiting, and now you're supposed to take this stuff to a meeting and you can't because the printer is stuck and IT isn't available. So now you're getting aggravated, you're getting frustrated, and someone else comes up and says, "What'd you do to the printer?" "I didn't do anything to the printer." So now we get knocked back a few yards.
That's right. That's right.
Okay? Yeah. So this is what is called life.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, does that say, okay, I've defeated. The game's over.
No.
No. Remembering our ultimate goal is still way down there, but all I need to do this week, we're just going to take the illustration of weeks. This week, all I need to do is just fight long enough to get right here. And once I get to that point, he moves to that point, and then, well, we don't have the room, and then Pastor Jim moves another 10 yards. And then we start to reach a new goal that week. If we think, we can go ahead and set those back against the wall. If we think, I have to reach a certain level, in the reality of it, it's going to take 6, 7, 8 promotions to get to that point at your job. You want to reach a certain level in your marriage, and it's going to take a year to get to that point. We need to realize that we should do things in life, as well as our relationship with God, 10 yards at a time. And if I don't succeed and get a touchdown, if I don't succeed and have a great revival and have an awesome time at work, which is the ultimate goal, as long as I am moving forward, as long as I'm moving the sticks, which is what is referred to.
Amen. That's a good point.
Obtainable goals every 10 yards. Let's look at this next point here, strong offense. Going back to the story of Peter. Now remember, we use this as the establishing point of this. When Peter has this transformation moment, Peter, at that point, didn't do everything right from that point on. We know in Peter's life, he had times that he tried to tell Jesus, "You don't need to go to the cross." And Jesus said what to him? "Get behind me, Satan." So he rebukes him at that moment. This is after Peter made this declaration, this proclamation of who Christ was. When then there's other situations, and Peter says, "I will follow you. I am so strong and on your side that I will follow you to the ends of the earth." And Jesus says, "No, you won't." He says, "Before the day's out, you'll deny me." No, I'll never do that. Have you ever been so strong in belief of something, like, no matter what happens, I will never go down that road? But then something might happen in your life, and the next thing you know, like, "Oh, man, I'm doing exactly what I promised everybody I would never do." Does that mean that your relationship is gone? Does that mean that you're a failure? No. Matter of fact, what we know what happens next is Peter denies he ever knew Jesus. These are all things that happened after Peter says, "You are the Christ, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." So Peter had a true grasp of who Jesus was. But he still screwed up. So, what does that tell us? Even when we have an understanding of the identity and purpose of Jesus in our lives, which we shared earlier, friend, healer, deliverer, foundation, rock. Even though we have an understanding of who he is, it doesn't mean that we're not going to screw up. Just like in a football game, you might be driving down the field and things going really, really well, and then you make a dumb call, and you get knocked back 10 yards or 15 yards. Or you get a penalty, and you get knocked back a handful. These are all things and mistakes that happen. But just like real life, and just like our relationship with God, we can make some decisions that separate us from God, not because he is separating himself, but because we have done something that moved us back 10 yards.
Come on.
It doesn't mean we failed, because we also know that in the end of the story, Peter is restored, fully restored back to Jesus, and Jesus says, "Feed my sheep." I love you. If you love me, do this. And then we know Peter's story and the radical impact that he had on the New Testament church, and we're still talking about Peter today. So even in all his mistakes, he still kept moving forward, 10 yards at a time, if you will. Strong offense. This section of scripture says, and I tell you, in verse 18, what we were talking about, and I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. Remember, Peter declared Jesus in person and position. He saw Jesus for more than just a man. Jesus then in turn declares Peter to be more than just a man. So it was Peter, in a sense, initially saying, Jesus, you are the Messiah. You are the chosen one. You are the anointed one. And Jesus in turn says, this has been revealed to you by God himself. And you are Peter, the rock. And then he talks about the church will be built upon and the gates of hell will not overcome it. Pastor Jim and a few of the staff, we were just in the office not too long ago talking about this. And I'm going to pull this as an illustration. So I'll give him partial credit because he did bring it up. If he wasn't here, I wouldn't give him
credit. Right, he's going to make it better now.
No, listen to this. Okay, the gates of hell will not overcome it. Now think about this. Let's go back to the football analogy. Defense lines up in a line. All right, your defensive line against you lines up in a line. In a sense, looks like a gate. Okay? Now, sometimes when we read this scripture, we think that, okay, I am just sitting here and I'm just being me. And hell, we read this and hell's coming at me. And it will not overcome me because of who I am, because of the strength I have. But the reality of what this is how I read this, and Pastor Jimmy even confirmed this when we talked about this. The reality of what this is that defensive line cannot stand up against what you have and the strength that you have because of him.
Amen.
So the gates of hell will not overcome. What that means is the gates cannot withhold your offense of moving forward. Your strong offense of moving forward. And not only will it not overcome, it will not defeat you, it will not bring you down. But here's the thing to understand. Just as much as we get past this defensive line, and we may get tackled 6, 7, 8 yards out further, that defensive line is going to set up again. The enemy is going to come at you again. Just because we had victory. You know, maybe we were having a discussion with our spouse, and your blood was beginning to boil, and you wanted to yell at her, and you wanted to do this, and you wanted to do that, but you didn't. You knew it was right to hold your tongue. You knew it was right to show grace or mercy. And you leave that event, you leave that activity in victory. You know, I did it. I've been trying so hard to watch my temper, and I succeeded. But 5, 6 yards later, you're going to have another opportunity to see if you hold your temper, if you hold your tongue.
That's right. Good point.
The last scripture, there's another scripture that I would add to this. It's interesting. Isaiah 59:19 can apply to this as well. It says, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up what? A standard. A standard against him. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Now listen to this. This is interesting. That word standard there, typically when we think of standard, we think of, okay, when the enemy is coming in like a flood, he's going to build a wall, or God's going to build something that's going to withstand that. But the word standard here, this is what it actually means in the original language. It's interesting. The word standard here is noose. And it actually means to flee, escape, take flight, or cause to disappear. That's what that word means in the original language. So here's how I see this. When the enemy comes in, going back to our football illustration, when the defensive line breaks down the offensive line and they come in and they start battling and they start pushing forward, there are times, and I'm going to use, I don't know if you're a Steeler fan or not, but if you're not, you may get this anyway. Le'Veon Bell, running back. There are times Le'Veon Bell, he kind of gets behind a big guy and he just kind of waits. If you follow the Steelers, you'll see that when he gets the ball, he doesn't always try to go through the line. Sometimes he'll get the ball and he'll just like,
yeah,
I'm just going to hang out here. Exactly. Almost like he's hidden. And then something opens up and he takes off. And really what this is saying here, it's actually meant to, it says take flight. So when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will lift up an opportunity for you to take flight, for you to take off into the enemy's territory in victory. And so as we look at these little illustrations of football and moving the sticks,
I just
want a little recap. First thing, identifying the person and position. Jesus and who he is in our life, and the significance that he is in our life. And not allowing the pressures of religion to bring us into a place of guilt. But as we move forward and we grow, just like our relationship with our wife, just like our relationship with our fathers and our bosses, we grow and we take the time that we have, we build the time we have, we read, we learn, and we grow, because those are all beneficial things. Don't walk away from here and say, Troy said we don't need to read the Bible anymore. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is remove the guilt when you don't fulfill your little religious obligation that you've put on yourself. Obtainable goals, 10 yards at a time. Just think of it that way. My desire is to be successful in whatever God is doing in my life, whether it be my temper, whether it be my money, whether it be my time with my family, whatever it is. My 10 yards is this week. And after this week, I'm going to start over. What that means, the good and bad of that is, the good is I get to start over because I might have screwed up last week. But I get to start over next week, and I'm going to continue my relationship with God. I'm going to continue moving forward. I'm going to continue not being burdened by guilt, but continue moving forward. And the bad of that is we might have had a great series and think, okay, now I can rest. Now I don't have to work. You know, this is one of the things that happens a lot of times when people who have battled addiction and they go through the process of recovery and all that kind of stuff, and they feel like, okay, now I'm on the other side. And they may go 3 months or 6 months without touching alcohol or touching drugs. And then they can begin to let their guard down and say, you know what, I'm doing okay. So I don't have to work as hard at these 10 yards because I seem to be doing okay. Well, the moment you do that, the moment you let your guard down, that defense is you. And way too often we see people fall back into sinful situations of their past because they let their guard down. Amen. So obtainable goals, 10 yards at a time, 1 week at a time. And then realize we have a strong offense. The gates of our defense, the gates of hell, cannot overcome us. Matter of fact, they cannot even defeat us moving forward in their territory. And ultimately, 10 yards at a time, 10 yards at a time, and might be one series you have 20 yards. And ultimately, you reach the end zone. It takes time, it takes work, but the main thing I wanted to kind of leave with you guys is remove the guilt, remove the pressure, remove the religious obligation,
yeah,
and just look to build the relationship. The fact of the matter is, I don't read the Word of God because I have to. I read and learn and study because I want to.
Oh, yes, come on.
And once you grasp, once you truly grasp that, you know, I spend time with my wife because I want to, not because, oh, you know what, I'm married and I need to get in my, you know, 3.5 hours of quality time with her this evening. No, you don't do that. You come home and you want to be with your wife. You desire to be with your wife. So it's not about obligation. It's not about religious responses. It's about, as I build that relationship with Jesus, I want to do this stuff. I want to learn. I want to grow. I want to read. I want to pray without ceasing. All those things are things that come because of the relationship. You don't get the relationship because you do those things. Those things come because of the relationship. Let's pray. Father, we love you and we thank you today. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to grow together. And I pray that each one of us continue to grow in your purposes and your calling. Bring to fruition, God, your desires in each life in this room. And Lord, I pray that we can look at the big picture, the big dream, the eventual outcome of your desires in us. And I pray, Father God, that we will look at the daily steps to take to get there. 1 yard, 2 yards, 5 yards, 10 yards at a time. And we will remove the guilt from the enemy to say that we're not good enough, we're not moving fast enough, we're not strong enough. Those are all lies of the enemy, Lord. We are just going to move forward, as little as it might be, move forward day by day, moment by moment, to accomplish your purposes. We thank you and we glorify you in all we do. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Amen. All right, thank you guys for coming.